Well, today, if you got your Bibles or if you want to follow along with us on the screen, you can look with me in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. It's Luke's account of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, probably one of my favorite accounts in Scripture. And listen to what the Bible says. It says, "Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen.'" Can I get an amen from somebody? "Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered in the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. And then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest." I want you to look at that first point with me this morning. I want you to just recognize a thought with me today. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. He is not on the cross. He is not in the grave. He has risen from the dead. And because the tomb is empty, our lives don't have to be. I want to just encourage you today, as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ and we celebrate the fact that the tomb is empty, I want you to hear me this morning. Because the tomb is empty, your life, my life, does not have to be empty. Let me just tell you something in case you hadn't figured this out. The American dream is a lie. The American dream is a lie. The American dream that if I can just have the big house and have the great job and have enough money, I can have the wonderful family, 2.5 kids. I'm still working on how you get 0.5. 2.5 kids. Then all of a sudden I'll be happy, right? My life will make sense and everything will be wonderful and everything will be great. But the truth is, there is an eternal void in the heart of every man, every woman, every boy, every girl on planet Earth that can only be filled with the resurrected power of Jesus Christ. Only Jesus can satisfy your soul. Only Jesus can fill the void of your life. And today, as we celebrate the fact that there's an empty tomb, we also celebrate the fact that our lives do not have to be empty. I love John chapter 10. It's one of my favorite verses. The Bible says this: "The thief has come but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said that I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." I love how the NLT says, it says, "I've come that you may have a rich and satisfying life." Yeah. Think about that. A rich, a life that is enriched with the goodness of God, a life that is satisfied. Wouldn't it be great to get up every day with a satisfied soul? Wouldn't it be great to know that you didn't have to get up every day and chase something just to make you happy, chase something just to fill that void, chase something just to get a little bit more of what you think you need to be happy in this world? Wouldn't it be great to live with a satisfied heart? Because here's the realization: only Jesus satisfies. For all the young people in here today, let me just encourage you in this. If you're a young person, there's not enough likes, there's not enough shares, and there's not enough followers on planet Earth to satisfy your soul. There's not enough. There'll never be enough people to applaud you. There will never be enough people to celebrate you for you to fill the void in your heart and your life. There's never enough money. There's never enough power. There's never enough position. There's never enough of anything in this world. And the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the power of the resurrection, is that because the tomb is empty, our lives don't have to be. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Apostle Paul tells us something. The Apostle Paul gives us the significance of the resurrection. He tells us how significant it is. I want you to understand today that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the foundation stone and the crown jewel of Christianity. On Friday, Good Friday, we celebrated the death of Jesus Christ. We remembered the price that he paid. But I want you to hear me today. His death on the cross without the resurrection from the tomb would have been powerless. He not only had to pay the price, but he had to conquer death, hell, and the grave in order for us to experience the redemption that he came to give. Jesus rose from the grave, and that is our foundation stone. And that is the crown jewel upon which we celebrate as Christians. Listen to what Paul said. 1 Corinthians 15. For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless. And your faith is useless. He goes on in verse 17. He says, and if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. Listen to what Paul said. He said, if there's no resurrection of the dead and if Jesus Christ has not been raised from the dead, then all our preaching and all of our faith is useless and in vain, and you and I are still lost in our sins, and everybody that's died believing in Christ is burning in hell today if there is no resurrection from the dead. If Jesus has not risen from the dead, then no one has hope. And without Christ, we're all lost. But he goes on in verse 19. He says, and if our hope is in Christ only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. And he is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. So you see that just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man. Just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. Everyone who belongs to Christ will be given brand new life. Now I want you to do something. I want us to look in Revelation chapter 1. Because today I want us to get a picture of the resurrected Christ. I want us to get an image of Jesus, not on a cross, not in a grave, but as the resurrected King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And in Revelation chapter 1, the Apostle John gives us this picture of Jesus, our resurrected Lord and Savior. Look what it says. He says, I, John, your brother and fellow partner in the tribulation and kingdom and perseverance which are in Jesus, was on the isle called Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. The Lord's day is Sunday. That's the first day of the week. That's the day of his resurrection. Saturday, according to the law, is the Sabbath. But Sunday is the Lord's day. That's why we as Christians worship on Sunday. Paul said, or John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like the sound of a trumpet. And then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. And having turned, I saw seven gold lampstands. And in the middle of the lampstands, I saw one like the Son of Man. That's Jesus. Clothed, look what it says, clothed in a robe reaching to his feet, girded across his chest with a golden sash. And his head and his hair were as white like were white like wool like snow. And his eyes were like a flame of fire. And his feet were like burnished bronze when they had been made to glow in the furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. I want you to get this image of Jesus. Because this is a picture of the resurrected Son of God. He is full of glory. He is full of power. His hair is white as snow. His eyes are burning with flames of fire. His feet are burning like bronze, like burning bronze. And all of a sudden, the Bible says his face shone like the brightness of the sun in all of its strength. And then the Bible goes on and says, it says, and in his right hand were seven stars. And out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in all its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead man. Amen. Let me just tell you today, when you get a real revelation of the resurrected Christ, it's not buddy, buddy, give me knuckles, Jesus. When you get a real revelation of the resurrected Christ, his presence demands reverence. His presence demands reverence. And when you get a real revelation of the resurrected Jesus Christ, you see the King in all his glory. You see eyes flaming fire. You see hair white as snow. You see the brilliance of the sun in his glory. You see seven stars in his right hand and the word of God coming out of his mouth as a sharp two-edged sword. Because his presence demands reverence. And when you see him, you're changed by him. John the Revelator said, and I fell at his feet like a dead man. And he placed his right hand on me and he said, do not be afraid, for I am the first and the last. I am the living one. Look at this. I was dead and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of Hades. He's the conquering king. Can I get an amen? Amen. I want you to look at that next point. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He conquered death, hell, and the grave, and he gives resurrection life to those who believe in him. Jesus is the resurrection and the life, and he gives resurrection life to those who believe in him. Yes. This morning, I want to just challenge us with a couple thoughts today. As I was praying over the last few weeks, preparing for the opportunity to share the Word of God this morning, I was thinking about the thought. The Holy Spirit quickened the thought in my heart. He said, Keith, he said, do you realize that we live in a culture today where people have this idea? It's a misconception. It's really a false conversion. This is what he said. He said, many people going to church are not going to heaven. Many of the people that are going to church are not going to heaven. See, there's this misconception that there can be a salvation without a transformation. And what we're going to see today is we're going to see how that when you put your faith in the resurrected Christ, that the resurrected power of God begins to transform your heart and your life from the inside out, and you can't stay the same. Let me give you a real life testimony. My wife, Pastor Kelly, right up here on the front row, we got married early. We were young and dumb is what we tell everybody. I was 18, she was 17. At age 20, I surrendered the call to preach and we started pastoring our first church. We pastored a little Methodist church. I was 20 years old, she was 19 years old. Can you imagine having a 20-year-old pastor? Everybody in the church was older than us. Right before we started pastoring, Kelly made a confession of faith in Jesus that he was her Lord and Savior. But 4 years later, after being the pastor's wife for 4 years, one night she was at home on a Tuesday night. I was out making some visits to people in the church. She was sitting there at home. I guess Jessica was the only one with you, or was Samantha there? Both the girls, Jessica and Samantha, our girls, were there. They were both little. Kelly was watching TBN, Christian television. There was a guy on there sharing the gospel, and he was about to give a salvation call. And as Kelly, the pastor's wife for 4 years, is sitting there, all of a sudden the Holy Spirit speaks to her, and he says, if you were to die right now, you would go to hell. If you were to die right now, you would go to hell. Why? Because she had a confession of faith, but she never had a transformation of heart and life. She had acknowledged Jesus, but she had never been resurrected by Jesus. She had nodded her head that he was who he said he was, but she had never yielded her heart to the lordship of Jesus Christ. And for 4 years, she was in church every Sunday. I mean, she lived with me every day. Come on, help her, Jesus. But she came to a place where she realized she had a false conversion. She was going to church. She was a pastor's wife. She was reading her Bible and she was praying. She was telling other people about Jesus. But she was lost and going to hell. How many of you understand today that Christianity is not a religion? It is a relationship. And salvation is not an intellectual decision that we make. It is a spiritual decision that transforms the hearts and the lives of people. Because the Bible tells us that we come to God. They that come to God must come by faith. How many of you know faith is not a head thing? Faith is a heart thing. Yes. Come on. Faith is believing even when you don't understand it. Faith is trusting even when you can't comprehend it. Faith is believing that God is true and his word is real even when it doesn't make sense to you. And at 23 years old, my amazing wife, on a Tuesday night at home in our living room watching TV, prayed a sinner's prayer, got born again. I came home that night and she told me what happened. She said, I got saved tonight. I said, that's awesome. I thought you were. Come on, Jesus. And then she said this to me. She said, now tomorrow night, we had Wednesday night church back in those days. She said, now tomorrow night when we go to church, everybody at church already thinks I'm saved, so let's not tell anybody. Because it might look bad for the pastor's wife to get saved, you know. I said, okay, it's your story to tell. I'm not going to tell anybody. We walked in that little Methodist church that next night at Wednesday night. We walked in the door. She probably didn't get three steps inside the door. And she said, hey, everybody, guess what? Last night I got saved. You know why? Because when your heart and life is transformed by the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, you can't be quiet, you can't stay quiet, you can't hide your light under a bushel, because God has done something real on the inside of you, and it's not a head thing, it's a heart thing, it's not an intellectual decision, it's spiritual transformation that happens through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so my prayer today for each and every one of us this morning is that if you're here today and you have a confession of faith where you've acknowledged Jesus, but you've never had a transformation of life, that maybe today would be your day. That like Kelly, 4 years after being a pastor's wife, you may come to a place that you realize, I need more than intellectual acknowledgement of God. I need heartfelt transformation by the Spirit of God. And the good news of the gospel is that's what Jesus, the resurrected Christ, came to give us. He wants to strip away the idea. Wouldn't it be sad that if you spent your life thinking you were a Christian because you prayed a prayer and went to church and then stood before God and heard God say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. Wouldn't that be a tragic day in your life? You were a good person, you were a moral person, but you weren't a born-again person. And you had never been saved. God wants to remedy that today. Amen? So let's look today at the Word of God. I want you to see a contrast from Scripture today. So what does it look like for us to live a resurrected life? The first thing is simply this. Resurrection life is first a Spirit-filled life. It's a Spirit-filled life. We are no longer controlled by the flesh. We are led by the Spirit. Resurrection life is Spirit-filled life. We're no longer controlled by the flesh. We are led by the Spirit. I want you to look with me in Romans chapter 8. We're going to read verse 11, and then we're going to back up and read verse 9, a couple verses before, because I want us to, first of all, get a picture of what Paul is saying, and then I want to read verse 9 because I believe it brings clarity to our hearts and our minds. So resurrection life is a Spirit-filled life. Look at Romans 8, 11. It says, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in who? Yeah. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. So listen to what Paul said. Paul said, if you are a Christian, if you are born again, if you are going to heaven, if you've experienced salvation, then the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. Because resurrection life is a Spirit-filled life that comes through the indwelling, empowering presence of the Holy Spirit. When you get born again, you know it. Somebody said, well, Pastor Keith, how do I know if I have the Holy Spirit? If you don't know it, you don't. If the Spirit of Christ that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, how many of you believe you ought to know that? Yeah. I mean, I'm not the sharpest crayon in the box, but come on, somebody. If the Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives in a person's heart, that person should know that something supernatural has happened in their heart, in their mind. They didn't just pray a prayer. They were transformed by the presence of God. And then verse 9, look what he says. Verse 9, we back up a couple verses. He says, but you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to Him at all. Paul said, if you haven't received the Holy Spirit, then you haven't received Christ, because the Holy Spirit is the resurrection power of Jesus Christ deposited into the hearts and lives of those who accept Jesus as their Lord and their Savior. And he says, and you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are now controlled by the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you something great that happened. When you get born again, God gives you a new want to. What do I mean by that? I don't have to go to church. I don't have to read my Bible. I don't have to pray. I don't have to give. I don't have to serve. I don't have to love people. I don't have to forgive people. I want to do those things. I want to go to church. I want to serve God. I want to bless people. I want to make a difference. I want my life to count for something that's eternal and that matters in the kingdom of God. When you get born again, guess what happens? You're no longer controlled by your sinful, selfish nature. Now you're controlled. Now you're guided. Now you're led. Now you're stirred by the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead. And now I have this desire to do the things that please God. Do I always do it? No, I still sin and come short of the glory of God. But I'm no longer controlled by that sin nature. I now have a new nature. And my want to's changed. Whenever I sin, sin is what happens when I compromise. It's not what happens when I live the life I really want to live. I want to please God. I want to serve God. I want to help others. I want to lead people to Jesus. I want to do what God has called me to do. Not because I'm a good person, but because the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in me. And if you've been born again, He lives in you, and you've got a new want to. Think about when you lived in the world, what you wanted to do. You wanted to have fun. You wanted to find the coolest party. Wanted to hook up with the hottest girl. Wanted to drink the most beer, get the greatest high. You wanted to lie, cheat, and steal as long as it could make you an extra dollar. And you didn't care who you hurt or how you hurt them, as long as at the end of the day you came out on top. But when you get born again, you're no longer controlled by that sinful nature. There's a new want to. Because now the Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. Look at that next point. Resurrection life is not only Spirit-filled life. Resurrection life is a fruitful life. Our lives will produce the fruit of new life. Literally, the fruit of the resurrection. Galatians chapter 5, I want us to listen to how the Apostle Paul describes the fruit of the Spirit. Literally, he is describing the fruit of a resurrected life. This is what it looks like when you're born again. This is what it looks like when Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life. This is what it looks like when resurrection power is abiding and dwelling in you. Look what he says, Galatians 5:22. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Who produces the fruit? The Holy Spirit. Man, this is the fruit of resurrected living. This is the fruit of what happens when Jesus Christ is Lord of your life. This is the fruit of what happens when the gift of the Holy Spirit begins to live and abide and dwell on the inside of you. Look what he says. The first fruit of the Spirit is love. Love. All of a sudden, you've got a love for God and a love for people that does not come from yourself. One of my greatest testimonies, Pastor Rick, who was our CR pastor for years, his testimony was this. He was a drug addict. He was an alcoholic. He was a drug dealer. He was about as wicked and evil as you could be. And he said, the greatest transformation that happened in my life when I got saved was simply this. He said, I went from hating everybody to loving everybody. I went from hating everybody to loving everybody. And guess what? It wasn't because everybody changed. It was because he changed. See, that's what the Holy Spirit does. That's what resurrection power does. All of a sudden, when you get born again, you go to work the next day with the people you've been working with for the last 10 years that you couldn't stand. And all of a sudden, you have compassion for them. And all of a sudden, your heart is moved toward those very people. The people you wanted to give them the right hand of fellowship are now the people you earnestly pray for. Because there's a love in your heart for them that does not come from you. It comes from God. They didn't change. You changed. And the fruit of the Spirit is love. The fruit of the Spirit is joy. The Bible says that in Christ we have joy unspeakable and full of glory. Y'all see Jennifer up here on this stage? I mean, she's like the Energizer Bunny. We pick on her all the time. Mike Shaw, who's done a lot of construction work at their house, he told me this one day. He said, Pastor Keith, he said, you know what? He said, Jennifer's like that all the time. He said, I've been over there at 7 o'clock in the morning, she's just like that. I've been over there at 7 o'clock at night, she's just like that. I've been over there on Saturday morning, she's just like that. And Stephen's like, yes, she is. Help me, Jesus. You know why? Because joy comes from Jesus. Joy comes from the Spirit. You don't have to get up every day and prime the pump to be happy. Ask Brother Curtis, how you doing today? And he'll say, I'm doing good. Brother Curtis, when did you have a bad day? Never. He's never had a bad day. Neither have I. You know why? Because this is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Bad things have happened. Horrible things have happened. Sorrowful things have happened. But there's joy in Jesus. And the fruit of the Spirit is there's joy. There's peace. There's peace. Years ago when we started Celebrate Recovery, people were getting saved, and they'd take shoe polish, and right on the back of their car, I found peace at Liberty Church. They really didn't find it at Liberty Church. They found it in Jesus. Because there's peace, peace of mind, peace of heart, peace in the family. I can't tell you how many marriages Kelly and I have ministered to when Jesus becomes the Lord of their life and they start embracing the resurrection Christ, Jesus Christ. All of a sudden, they go from hating each other, they go from strife and discontention and chaos and confusion to a place where peace reigns in their home. Because when peace reigns in you, guess what? Peace can rule through you. Patience. Everybody always says, don't pray for patience. You don't have to. The Holy Spirit gives it to you. You don't have to pray for patience. The Holy Spirit gives it to you. All of a sudden, you become patient. You become long-suffering with people. What used to get on your last nerve might take a lot longer now. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness. Think about this. Some of the worst sinners make the best saints. Because you take those mean, angry, scruff, critical, judgmental, hating everybody, not liking anyone, can't say anything good about anybody, and all of a sudden they get raised to life through Jesus Christ. And they become kind, and they become gentle, and they become caring, and they become compassionate. And all of a sudden those big old grizzly bears become teddy bears. Because of Jesus. And I'm looking at a few teddy bears out there today. And I'm glad you're not who you used to be. Amen. I mean, I'd have to tote a gun just to be around you. That's how bad you were. Come on, somebody. Self-control. Let me give you one last thought on this, and we're going to move on. Self-control. The fruit of the Spirit is self-control. Do you remember before you got saved how any thought that ran through your mind had to run out your mouth? I mean, you thought it and you said it. And think about it. You hurt everybody you loved. Your tongue was full of bitter poison, strife, chaos. You wounded the people you loved the most because if it ran through your mind, you felt like it had to run out your mouth. And there was no self-control. But the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. All of a sudden, you have a divine restraint that enables you to say no. Listen to me. This is the most powerful thing you'll ever learn in Christ. It enables you to say no to yourself. The greatest restraint you'll ever experience in your life is the ability to say no to yourself. And that doesn't come from willpower. That comes from resurrection power. And all of a sudden, instead of your tongue being a sword that brings pain and pierces hearts, it can be a wellspring of life that gives hope and healing and peace to the people you meet. Now, Galatians 5, let's back up a little bit again. Because in Galatians 5, the Apostle Paul gives us the contrast of what it looks like to live a resurrected life with the fruit of the Spirit and to live in sin under your old nature. Look what he says, Galatians 5, 19 through 21. He says, and when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Listen to this. He says they're very clear. This is not rocket science for all you engineers out there. This is clear. It's obvious. Here's the picture of resurrection life. We just read it. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. And here's the fruit of a life not resurrected in Christ. Here's the fruit of a life still living under the control of their sinful nature. It's very clear. Look what he says. Listen to it. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, adultery, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outburst of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these, just in case he missed something. And let me tell you again, as I have told you before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Paul said, here's the resurrected life. Here's the old life still lived in sin. Now you discern which are you. He said, it's really clear. It's not confusing. It's not cloudy. It's not distorted. There's a life that reflects the resurrection. And there's a life that reflects the old sin nature. And you can't live both. But you can live one. And you and I can live that resurrected life because of Jesus. Can I get an amen? Amen. Resurrection life, look at that next point, is not just a life that produces fruit. It's a supernatural life. We will do what Jesus did and greater works. Pastor Keith, that's a pretty bold statement. You're right, I would never say it, but Jesus did. Resurrection life is a supernatural life. We will do what Jesus did in greater works. John 14, verse 12. Listen to what the Bible says. Jesus is speaking. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to the Father. He who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these. Look at this. Why are we going to do greater works? Because he goes to the Father. And what did he tell us in John 14 and John 16? He said, when I go to the Father, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's going to empower you to do what I did. Let's think about this for a second. Let me ask you a simple question. Are you doing what Jesus did? Are you praying for people? Are you ministering to people? Are you loving people? Are you serving people? Are you helping people? Are you caring for broken people? Are you touching untouchable people? Are you pointing people to God? I mean, that's what Jesus did everywhere he went. He prayed for people. He ministered to people. He loved people. He discipled people. He cared for people. He fed hungry people. He clothed naked people. He set demonic people free. He did the works. And everything that he did was pointing. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. We can do the works that he did. Liberty Church is a church filled with supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles. As I look across this room here today, I see the testimony of lives that have been changed, bodies that have been healed, supernatural manifestations of his glory. And here, let me just encourage you in this. The reason that most Christians don't see what Jesus saw is because they don't do what Jesus did. If you don't pray for sick people, they'll never get healed. If you don't share the gospel with lost people, they'll never get saved. If you don't encourage and strengthen saved people, they'll never get discipled. If you don't care for hurting people, they'll never get healed. If you don't minister to people who are bound by the enemy, they'll never get set free. Jesus said that the resurrection life is a supernatural life. It's a life of simply doing what Jesus did. Well, Pastor Keith, I can't do what Jesus did. Yeah, you can. You can pray. You can minister, you can encourage, you can give, you can bless, you can help people, you can serve people, you can use your gifts to make a difference in somebody else's life. Guess what? Our job is obedience, his job is results.
Yes. Amen. That's true.
Right? If I'll do what Jesus did, then Jesus will do what I can't do. I can't save people, I can't heal people, I can't deliver people, but he can. So if I'll do what he did, he'll do what I can't do. Why? Because the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me and lives in you. Resurrection life is a supernatural life. Last point, here it is. Resurrection life is eternal life. Listen to what the Bible says. I'm going to just give you a quote, and then we're going to read it from Scripture. The Apostle Paul says, we won't all die, speaking to Christians, but we will all be transformed. Resurrection life is eternal life. How many of you recognize that not only do we have resurrection power, but one day if you die before Christ returns, you're going to literally be raised from the dead? A physical, bodily, supernatural resurrection. And if you live to see Christ, and by the way, we are seeing more of the signs of the time now than any other generation, I believe, on planet Earth. I believe that this generation could be the generation to literally see the coming of Christ as he comes again. And I want you to listen to what Paul says. 1 Corinthians 15. He says, What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. Here it is. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. And it will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. The dead in Christ, King James says, will rise first. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. And our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. And then when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, come on somebody, thank God, he gives us the victory, come on somebody, over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Resurrection life is eternal life. I want you to listen to one last scripture, John chapter 11. Jesus is speaking to Martha. Lazarus, her brother, has been dead in the grave for 4 days, to the point that the Bible says his body already began to stink with decay. And Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. And anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. And everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. And then he asked the million-dollar question, do you believe this? Do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that Christianity is not just a religion of do's and don'ts, but it's a relationship with God that produces supernatural transformation in our hearts and our lives? Salvation without transformation may not be salvation at all. And I want to just challenge us today. I want you to go ahead and just stand to your feet if you would. Let's just bow our heads for just a moment. I want our prayer teams to come. And I want to open the altar this morning. And I want to ask you a simple question today. Do you have resurrection life? Do you have resurrection life? Because today, you need to look within. The greatest tragedy on planet Earth would be going to church, but not going to heaven. Living your life thinking you're a Christian when in reality you know you're still the same person you were before you prayed that prayer. I'm not saying everything changes immediately, but I am saying that many things do. There is an immediate supernatural transformation that happens at salvation. Because when the Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, you can't stay the same. And today God is calling us. He's calling us to come out of any confusion, to come out of any gray area. Don't be trusting in, well, I prayed a prayer years ago, or I shook the preacher's hand, or I joined the church. Don't be trusting in superficial things. Trust in the fact that the resurrection power of God has transformed your heart and your life. and you know that you're not who you used to be. I'll be honest with you today, I am not who I fully want to be. But I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt that at 15 years old, when I got born again and the Spirit of God came in my life, I immediately became someone I had never been before, because my heart changed and my life changed. We're going to go into this last song of worship, and I want to just open the altar today. If you're not sure of your salvation, if you want to know today that resurrection power is in your life, then I want to just ask you to come. Our prayer teams would love to pray with you. We'd love to just lead you in a very simple prayer of trusting Jesus. Because today it can go from your head to your heart. It can go from your mind to your spirit. And today you can be resurrected to new life in Jesus. So let's just worship the Lord. The altar's open right now. If you need to come, you come, as we worship Him together. Today, wondering
this gift of love,
if you have resurrection life.
Scorned by the world,
don't leave here counting on something that happened in the flesh but never manifested in your life.
The wrath of God,
Jesus loves you. He died for you. He rose again on the third day so that none would perish, the Bible says, but that all would come to repentance. And tonight He's inviting you, or today He's inviting you just to come. He's simply saying, come. Come unto Me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He rose again. And as He stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am His and He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
The Bible says there's no salvation in any other name other than the name of Jesus.
The solid rock,
and today He died for you and He rose again. He's calling you and He's calling me to Himself.
Ground is sinking sand.
Don't wait. Don't miss this moment. Don't allow fear.
On Christ the
don't allow pride.
Rock,
don't allow anything in your life to keep you from responding to who Jesus Christ is.
Sinking
and saying, God, today I need resurrection power. I need Jesus to be my Lord and my Savior.
Guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man.
Come on, sing it out, church.
Till He returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till He returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ. Christ I stand.
Amen. I want everybody just to bow your heads for a moment. Creed is just going to play softly for us. The altar's open. If you need prayer, I want you to come right now. This is your moment. But I really feel like I just don't want to miss a moment. I want to give everybody an opportunity today. If you're here this morning, with every head bowed, every eye closed, you're here today. You say, you know what, Pastor Keith? Maybe I've professed Christ. Maybe I've go to church. But when you were talking about that resurrection life, you weren't talking about my life. I'm not being led by the Spirit. I'm still following my flesh. I'm not producing the fruit of the Spirit. I'm still being governed by the things of this world. I'm not doing the things that Jesus does. And just to be honest with you, I really don't have a desire to even do any of those things. But I realized this morning that I'm lost. The greatest revelation you can get of your life is that without Christ, you're lost. And as the Holy Spirit spoke to Kelly on that Tuesday night many years ago, he said, if you were to die right now, you would go to hell. I want to flip that coin and ask you, do you know without a shadow of a doubt today that if you were to die right now, you'd go to heaven? Do you know that? Do you know that if you were to die this very moment, you would go to heaven? Because if you don't know that with 100% certainty today, then I'd love to pray with you. So with every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here today, you say, Pastor Keith, I don't know that today, but I want to know that. I want to accept Jesus. I want you just to slip your hand up. Just raise your hand. Hands are going up across the building. Just slip your hand right now. Just leave that hand high. Our ushers are going to come. They're going to slip a packet in your hand. I'm going to pray with you in just a moment. But say, Pastor Keith, today, I don't know that for sure I'm going to heaven, but I want to settle that today. I believe Jesus died. I believe he rose again, and I want to trust him today as my Lord and my Savior. If an usher can't get to you today, that's okay. They'll be at the back doors, and you can grab a packet on the way out. We just want to follow up with you. We want to help you take that next step. So for every hand that went up, this is for you. I want everybody in the room to pray this prayer with me. But if you've raised your hand, this is for you right now. Let's say it out loud. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins and rose again on the third day. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart and my life. Be my Lord and my Savior. Raise me from the dead. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise this morning. Amen. If you prayed that prayer before you leave on your way out today, don't go anywhere right now. Let me let you go ahead and just take your seats for just a second. Miss Susie, if you want to come. If you prayed that prayer this morning, welcome to the family of God. Amen. Come on, give a shout one more time, church. We're glad to have you. Our ushers are at the back door. When you leave today, if you'll just let them know you prayed that prayer, they got a packet they'd love to give to you. We want to help you take that next step. Now, I'm going to have Miss Susie. Susie and Stephen are our children's pastors, and they do such an awesome job taking care of our kids. Come on, let's give them a round of applause. So I'm going to say two things, and then I'm going to let her give us egg instructions. So we've got a photographer going to be out front after the egg hunt at the corner of the building. When you came in, there's a big cross with a purple sash. He's going to be taking photos of individuals and families. So if you want to get a family photo or get a picture made, you can stop by there. You can also get pictures with your phone, whatever you want to do. Also want to let you know, during the egg hunt or after the egg hunt, we're going to have our golf carts are going to be loaded down with ice cream. So you're going to see our ice cream trucks driving around out back there. Make sure to wave one down, get you an ice cream, and enjoy a special treat on us today. And Miss Susie's going to give us instructions now.
All right. Okay, sorry. All right, so first and foremost, please pick your kids up. There are lots and lots of kids upstairs, which is amazing, but it is a small space, and it's already congested on a normal Sunday, and so we have extra families here and friends here. So please be patient. Make sure you have your tag ready to go. They're not going to release your kids without that tag. So whether you have it on your phone, on that the text message or that tag. Whoever is going up, I just ask that you send one person up. Whoever goes up to get your child, make sure you have that tag, okay? They are going to be coming back with a little Jesus and a ticket. Their ticket should have their first and their last name on it. If they don't have their ticket, that is okay. Or if you are in service, you are a child in service, fifth grade or under, there will be tickets. Miss Dahlia is going to be at a black table, and she has tickets, and you can just put your first and your last name on that. You're going to take your ticket, and there's some baskets and little stuffed bunnies, and you can put it in whichever cup you want to interest you the most. And then you're going to have your child go to their age group or their grade group. So we have nursery, our birth through two-year-olds, and then we have our pre-K kids, which are 3 through 5 years old, and then we have kindergarten through second and third through fifth grade. So we've split those up. Just have them stand kind of at that threshold and wait, and then we will give you the all good to go to send them out and pick up eggs. Please, if you could just remind your child to be mindful. We've got a lot of kids, and we want to make sure that every kid gets some eggs. Before I forget, there are these bags. So if, I saw some of you guys brought your own bags, your baskets, and that's awesome, but some didn't. So we have these He Is Risen bags. So we'll be passing those out, so make sure you get one of those. And then after the egg hunt, we will do the raffle. And I'm just going to call out that first and last name best that I can. So just be hanging around that area, and we'll get that going.
Out by the egg fields, that'll all be?
Yes. Okay. So that's got to all be out by, the egg fields. And the egg fields are going to be out in this back area. So when you go out the cafeteria doors.
Then go out the cafeteria doors.
You're going to go out the cafe doors, and then right to your left are going to be the baskets and extra tickets if you need to put your child's name on a ticket. And we're going to be passing out those bags. And then to the left, the right, is going to be all of the fields. And it starts out with nursery, the pre-K, kindergarten through second, and then third through fifth.
Signs on every field, so you'll know which age group there is.
Signs on every field. We sprayed for Aunt Bets the best that we could. I was running around putting eggs out. I didn't get bit. Praise Jesus. So please just be mindful. Keep a lookout as well. But we did try and treat them all.
And we're going to give about 15, 20 minutes for everybody to get their kids picked up. So, but we'll try to make sure everybody is out there. But once you get your kids, we're going to go out back. You can go out the cafe doors. If you go out the front, you can just circle around right behind the pavilion. And you'll see the egg fields, the tables, all the stuff. Miss Susie, let's give them a round of applause one more time. We love you. Anything else? Awesome. All right. Well, God bless you. Grab your little Jesus on the way out. If you don't get one, come back next Sunday and we'll have some more. And let's have some fun. We love you guys.